Well, Stuart already said it, it's Super Bowl Sunday. For some of us, it's one of the most exciting days of the year. For some of us, it's another Sunday to have a great nap and ignore all the goings-on in the sports worlds. Well, Holly found this meme the other day. It says, you know, you should want to go to church as much as you like the Super Bowl. So your pastor makes a really good point, pour Gatorade over his head. Apparently, someone took that seriously. I wore my suit today hoping that no one would do that. I saw someone go to the store, and they better not be getting the Gatorade. Callie, it's up to you to give me a heads up warning. Go like this if they're coming with Gatorade, and I will run, and I'll put high behind Stuart or something. That's good. Well, they're fighting for today. It's the Falcons and the Patriots. I know there's a couple of Pats fans, right, Jeanette? Woo, go Pats. Okay, Joe, too. All right, so there's at least a couple in the house, three. And the Falcons are fighting today for the Vince Lombardi Trophy. This thing is a beautiful trophy. They say it stands 22 inches, or 56 centimeters tall, weighs 7 pounds, and depicts a football in a kicking position on a three concave sided stand, and is entirely made of solid sterling silver. The words Vince Lombardi Trophy, along with the Roman numerals of that year's Super Bowl, are engraved on, and an NFL shield is affixed onto the base. After the trophy is awarded, it is sent back to the Tiffany's, which is the company who designs it, to be engraved with the names of the participating teams, the date, location, and the game's final score. It's then sent back to the winning team for them to keep, and smaller replicas are made for each person on the winning team. Wow, quite a bit of an ordeal to make this little trophy. You know, just for those New England Patriot fans out here, they're tied right now for third most Lombardi trophies, and if they win today, they'll be tied for second most Lombardi trophies ever. Just, you know, in case there's any other Pats fans out there. Anyways, Falcons have none. So, our next slide is kind of funny. You may not be able to read this, so I'll read it for you. So, this first guy here on the top left is Tom Brady. He's the main quarterback for the New England Patriots. And he says, I tried calling you yesterday, you didn't pick up. And the person there is Eli Manning, and Eli now is, or Peyton, sorry, getting my guys mixed up. The brothers, they look so much alike, right? They both have two Super Bowl rings, so I always get confused. This is before Peyton had his second. He says, yeah, sorry, Tom, I was busy. So Tom says, notice your voicemail said you have reached the greatest quarterback of all time. So he says, oh yeah, just having a little fun. And he goes, ha, I'm surprised it went to that message just after one ring. Tom Brady has four Super Bowl rings. Anyways, all the Super Bowl fans caught that one. Now, the Super Bowl ring is something that, if you are a champion, you wear that ring with pride everywhere you go. I've even heard it said that on a resume, you know, Fortune 500 countries look for Super Bowl players, because they know they're champions, they know they're athletes who can make things happen, and they know that this is a person who knows what it takes to win. And so they chase after these kinds of people. It's the symbol they carry with them wherever they go. It's important to them. It's a sign, it's a sign or symbol of all the blood, sweat, and tears, which were the price paid for victory. And it's amazing, don't you think? How many people today around North America are going to claim a victory today that isn't even their own? They didn't do anything to deserve it, not themselves. All the armchair coaches across North America tonight will be screaming and yelling and eating chicken wings as they watch other people do the work. And they will carry around and flaunt their symbols of this great victory for about 300 days. Well, Christians, you know, we carry a symbol around us too, don't we? It's the cross. Back in the 90s, when I was a teenager, I went to a youth rally and we made our own wooden cross. It's at an Anglican youth rally. I was so excited about it. And I wore this cross proudly to school. And one day I lent it to one of my friends to wear. And which is kind of funny. It was just, I guess it was a... Pastor got reflexes. Now I'm in for next year. Dear heavens, I'll wear a wetsuit or something. I'll wear my overalls. That's what I'll do next year. Shouldn't have put that picture up. Oh, man. Dude, like Stuart Caleb and the Settle Boys, I'm in trouble. Okay, keep going here. So I used to wear this cross around my neck. And a letter to one of my friends, who wasn't even a churchgoer, had no faith, and he just wanted to wear it because he thought it was cool. He knew it meant something to me. Well, anyways, I get it back, and there's teeth marks in my cross. And I'm like, what happened to my cross? Well, I got a friend, he said, that worships Satan, and I went like this to him, and he grabbed it and bit your cross. I'm like, what? Anyways, it was a thing. Wearing a cross right your neck, there's an authority and there's a power about the symbol, but nothing like Hollywood, right? It's a symbol that points to our living God. It's not the actual cross that has power. My little wooden cross that I wear on my neck has no power, but it affiliates me with Jesus Christ and the work he did on the cross, all the blood and sweat and tears that paid for victory that I did nothing to earn. And yet I claim it as my victory. And I wore that cross for many years. I still have it somewhere. I had one unchristian friend, non-Christian, non-church, whatever, said to me, you know, why don't you wear an electric chair around your neck? You know, it was a device of torture. I said, see, there's a difference. You see, an electric chair leads to the end of a life. Its sole goal is punishment and discipline. The cross, on the other hand, was not the sign of the end, but the sign of my beginning. It's a symbol of hope. It's a symbol that what was done to one man has cleared the way for all other people. It's a symbol of hope. It's been an embodiment of all the blood, sweat, and tears shed for us at Calvary, where Christ died for us. This morning we sang a song during our time of communion called Love Ran Red. And I want to walk you through this song. This is Chris Tomlin's song. The words are so beautiful. And we're going to close the service with the song this morning, because it's Communion Sunday and we're celebrating the cross. We're celebrating what was done. Chris Tomlin says, there's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. Where it reigns and rules. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. Where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. You're thinking, you know, what's our experience of Jesus? When we meet Jesus for ourselves, is it a place where we find mercy? When you meet Jesus in church, is it a place where you find love? What is your experience of Jesus? Maybe you've experienced the other kind of Jesus, the religious Jesus that's been portrayed through self-righteousness, a thing where people brag about how good they are, what they've done, and, well, you're just a worm. You know, as Christians, we can't brag about ourselves. We can only brag in the cross. Galatians 6:14, Paul says this, As for me, may I never boast about anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because of that cross, he says, my interest in this world has been crucified, and the world's interest in me has also died. The chorus goes on to say, at the cross, I surrender my life. And I'm in awe of you. Have you thought about the cross? When I think about the cross, the word awe is so fitting, because awe is just like almost dumbstruck. You're just, what do I say to the cross? How do I respond to the cross? We were talking in our prayer meeting this morning how the cross is an attitude changer. It changes everything. When we approach life and we look at the cross and we're in awe of what Christ has done for us, we believe that God can change anybody. Chris Tomlin says, when your love ran red, and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to Jesus. Oh and ah. One letter difference, but all connected. I'm humbled. I'm dumbfounded at the thought of the cross. Isaiah 1:18 says, come. Come now. Let us settle the matter, says the Lord. Let us settle it. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they are as red as crimson, they shall be like wool. God desires to settle the matter, and he sends Jesus Christ himself, his own son, the title, to go to the cross and make us white as snow. It's our hope. The song continues and says, there's a place where sin and shame are powerless. Amen. Because there's nothing worse than the feeling of guilt or shame that the enemy tries to put on us. But in light of the cross, in our relationship with God, they're powerless. In our relationship with our brothers and sisters in Christ, in light of the cross, we can receive forgiveness. And we can offer forgiveness. It says, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. I just picture standing under a waterfall and just being cleansed. Has anyone here ever stood under a strong waterfall? It's an amazing feeling. It kind of hurts sometimes if it's too strong, but it's still amazing. Isaiah 53, 4 and 6 says this, surely, surely, surely. It only says it once. He took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds, we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. This is the book of Isaiah, hundreds of years before Jesus Christ went to the cross. It's one of the, what I call, canonized messianic scriptures. It's been understood hundreds of years before Jesus Christ came that this was a messianic scripture. This had to do with the Messiah. And we recognize that what Jesus Christ did on the cross was for us. Chris Tomlin finishes his song by saying, here my hope is found. Here on holy ground. Here I bow down. Here, arms open wide. Here at the cross, you saved my life. Here I bow down. Here I bow down. We can give our lives to Christ. We can give our lives to what God has given us. The cross. His Son. In closing, I'll ask the worship team to come up. John 3:16. Most of you know it by heart. But let's remind ourselves of what it says. For God so loved the world. Not for God so condemned the world. Not for God said, wow, that place is dark and nasty. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. That's the title. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. That's what the cross represents. It represents his blood washing down over us, cleansing us, making us white, making us new, and our hopes are founded on something solid and real. Do you believe this morning? Has shame and guilt weighing you down? There's no need of it. Take those things, bring them to the cross. make your relationship with God right. And then your horizontal relationships with people, make those right with God's help to the best of your abilities. But don't live under shame or guilt. Don't live under the power of sin. Come under the washing, cleansing blood of Jesus Christ at the cross. Let's worship together.